Welcome to the council meeting. My name is Dave Woods. I'm a councilor with the city of Surrey. I'm the acting mayor for the month of March, and I'll be chairing the meeting this evening. Can I ask you if there's anybody in the audience that's got their cell phone on, if they could turn it off, please, or set it to vibrate? It's very much appreciated. So we'll start off with the agenda. We'll start off with adoption of minutes, please.
I'll move the adoption of the special council February 20th.
Second.
All those in favor? Contrary? Carried.
And I'll move the council in committee of February 20th, the minutes to be adopted.
Second.
All those in favor? Contrary? Carried.
Move the minutes of the regular land use council meeting on February 20th, 2017.
Second.
All those in favor? Contrary? Carried.
And move the regular council public hearing February 20th, 2017.
Second.
All those in favor? Contrary? Carried. I wonder if I get a motion from council, please, that we can move the corporate report R045, as we have a staff member here, before the public hearing.
Also move that.
Second.
Second. All those in favor?
Which one was
opposed? That's carried. Thank you very much for attending. We're moved now into public hearings.
Do you want to move that? Deal with that report now? Or
yeah.
No?
Pardon me?
Do you want to deal with that report?
So you moved it, so we
seconded. All those in favor? Did I not call for...
No, so you need to entertain the report.
Thank you very much.
I'll second the recommendations.
Thank you very much.
It's on the taxi licensing.
Okay, all those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Okay, we're moving on now to the delegations with regards to public hearing. Number one, can I get a motion, please? Oh, no, we don't.
Madam Clerk.
Yeah. Madam Clerk, go ahead.
The first public hearing is Zoning Amendment Bylaw 19158. The address is 15330 28th Avenue. The applicants are Stephen and Gordana Barrett. The applicant is seeking to rezone the site from single-family residential to single-family residential 10. The applicant is proposing to subdivide the property into four single-family lots, small lots.
Okay, we have no correspondence on table. We have no indication that anyone is willing to speak on this or wants to speak on it, so I'm going to make a call here. Is there anyone that wishes to speak to this matter? This is the first call. This is the second call for anyone who wishes to speak to this matter. This is the third and final call for anyone who wishes to speak in this matter. Thank you, Madam Clerk.
Next up is Official Community Plan Amendment Bylaw 19155 and Zoning Amendment Bylaw 19156 and Zoning Amendment Bylaw 19157. The addresses are 9822 and 9834 179th Street. The applicant is Canadian Horizons 179th Street Land Corporation. The applicant is seeking to redesignate a portion of the site from suburban to urban and rezone the site from 1 acre residential to comprehensive development, single family residential. The applicant is proposing to subdivide the site into 11 single family lots with two oversized transitional CD lots on the northeast portion and 9 RF lots on the southwest portion of the site. Portions of Lot 11 will remain undeveloped until future consolidation with the property to the north, 9868 179th Street.
Okay, thank you very much. We have one piece of correspondence that is concerned with regards to the street parking, the trees replacement, building guidelines, and environmental concerns. We have 16 people in attendance who have indicated that they are in support of the project before us, but they do not wish to speak. And then we have two speakers that wish to speak. I'll call the first one is Heather Nordine, please.
So Dave, is it Arthur Lucy that you have the correspondence
from?
Arthur Lucy. Is this who you have the correspondence from?
That's the correspondence I'm referring to.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Yes, go ahead, Heather.
Hi, hello, Council.
Now, I wonder if you could just state your address, please.
Oh, my name's Heather Nordine, and my address is 9848 180A Street.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak. I support this application. It fits well with the culture, community, and standard of living of the Fraser Heights neighborhood. And as a resident, I appreciate necessary development projects which meet these needs. I'd like to express a desire to see services come to meet the growing needs of the community, mainly a shopping center, schools, and transit to meet the growing population. I was disappointed to see the last application not get sent back to planning despite the overwhelming opposition turnout. Council incorrectly assumed the residents were unwilling to compromise. I would like to express that as a resident, I'm more than willing to see to work with the developers and the city to come to development proposals that will meet the needs of the city but maintains the expectations of existing residents. This is a prime example of a development that works well with our community, and as such, I'm happy to provide my support to it. Thank you very much for your time.
Okay. Do we have any questions? No? Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Next one is a Daniel Nam, please.
Good evening, Council. So my name is Daniel Nam. I currently reside at 9889 188th Street, so just one street down. So I'm not necessarily opposed to the redevelopment, but I think just given all the fervor that happened with, I think with bylaw 19126 and, you know, the amount of housing and development that's going on there, I just wanted to, you know, Not necessarily juxtapose that with this, but I think I wanted a little bit of clarity from the developer as to the impact at the end of the day of how many houses are actually coming into this area. So, I mean, there are a lot of large lots that are currently in this kind of section of Fraser Heights in Abbey Ridge. And, again, I support development. I support, you know, updating that area. That road in particular, 179, is quite bad. It's very narrow. I'm sure many residents can speak to that. And so I think development along there is fine. But I think, you know, given the fact that I've lost track of how many houses are coming along that Lysian Drive development, and then on this particular corner, you know, you have two lots that are, you know, one size, and you have another nine that are much smaller. I'm assuming that the two large ones were kept that size to kind of maintain consistency with the houses on the kind of the 180A, that cul-de-sac. But I guess I just wanted that clarity as to whether or not there's been thought to the incidents and the number of housing and people that are going to come into this. Because I think, you know, these are single dwelling homes, but, you know, I have to assume that it's going to be, you know, 40, 50, 60 extra individuals, families are coming in, and if they have tenants, then, you know, I don't know how many extra it is. And it's just, so I think, you know, similar to the last individual that spoke, like, I would like an opportunity to have a conversation or to work with the developers. So again, it's not that I think the residents in this area are opposed to it, but I think a lot of them, they've kind of lost faith in the system. And I've talked to a lot of my neighbors, and I asked them, you know, are you going to come to the council meeting today? But I think some of them have had this approach of, like, what's the point? It's going to go through. We complained about this last development, and there was a lot of angst against it, and it still went through, so there's no point. And I guess for me, it's not so much about, you know, changing the council's mind, but just kind of reiterating again, you know, my voice as a citizen, just to, on behalf of my neighbors as well, because I think, you know, I may not be directly impacted by this street, but I'm one block down, and when that next cul-de-sac comes in, I will be impacted. And I think my neighbors, when we were discussing 188 Street and how that was going to be developed, I think it was a year and a half ago, those neighbors came and also, you know, on our behalf, you know, supported and our position on that. So I think I'm here for them really more, and so that I can kind of go back to them and report to them. So I think more than anything, yeah, I just want to make sure that there's been proper thought to this area, because it's really gone through a lot of development, right? You have the whole construction on Daly Drive, that with their South Fraser Perimeter Road coming in. You have Highway 17, you know, that construction there. Yeah. You have Barnston and all the work that's going on there, along with Highway Number 1. So there's just been a lot of impact to that area, and I think a lot of the residents have felt that. So I think this is just like another development, I think. So.
Okay, sir. Yeah. I'll tell you what. We've got a couple of councillors here who want to ask you some questions.
Sure.
Councillor Gill.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Sir, I understand that the local area plan that was done for this particular area was completed in December 2015. Mm-hmm. Just wanted to understand, just from your perspective, were you aware of a local area plan that was happening, and did you participate?
I was aware of it. I wasn't able to participate directly, but I did speak with my neighbors about it, and you know, I know a lot of them did. So, and then there were also previous. I mean, to be quite honest, I've kind of lost track of the number of public hearings and for all the developments in this area. So I did participate in some. Again, with this one, this is the first time I'm speaking about it.
If I recall correctly, you know, again, what we have before us is the application in front of us.
Yeah.
But specifically, I do recall the Fraser Heights Community Association president suggest that they were quite in favor of RF lots, and we do have RF lots and greater lot sizes that we have in front of us today.
Yeah.
So I just want to understand from your perspective today, are you suggesting that there are just way too many lots, or is there the lots too big? I'm just not understanding your comments.
Think for me, it's just probably the number of the 9 lots that are coming in, because to me it seems a little bit inconsistent with the rest of the homes that are on the other side of that. So I suspect that it's probably to maintain some consistency with the development that's coming along Lysian. I don't know. But to me, it's like when you have a lot of this size and you have 2 homes on one end of that cul-de-sac, and then you're trying to squeeze in 9 on the other side. Obviously, as a resident, there's going to be a lot of traffic and increased, you know, all of that. But I think I just didn't understand the rationale behind that. If it's just to maximize spacing, then that's fine. But for me, when I look at it, just, you know, even just logically, I would have thought that they would have been spaced out a little bit more.
So I'm always concerned when I hear residents that indicate that they weren't part of a process. Mm-hmm. Is there anything that we could have done better in this process to better engage you, your neighbors, in terms of your concerns that you've mentioned today?
You know, that's a great question. I think, on one hand, I think the city has done a good job of sending out notices. I think it's a combination of things. I think you mentioned, you know, the Fraser Heights Community Association. So I think that is a great place to have dialogue, because I think a lot of residents, they're probably more vocal there because they're not standing in front of council. So it's probably more of a different arena. But I think some of it, quite honestly, is, I wouldn't say it's apathy, but I think they've just not given up hope, but I think they've kind of resigned themselves to the fact that this area has gone through a lot of construction, and it is what it is. And so on one hand, like, the cynical side of me says, you know, if you had engaged the residents more, would they really feel that their voices would make a difference? I don't know. Like, for me, I try to be positive about that, and I think, because my experience with the council, I think a year and a half ago when I came here to speak, was positive, right? And even though it was only like 5 of us speaking, it did make a change in terms of how our street was going to be developed. I think it is a little bit complex.
Yeah, I do find it frustrating. I think that when this local area plan was adopted, if I recall correctly, there's not even one soul that had shown up to suggest that they had concerns. So again, you know, processes and then doing the engineering stage 2, that was all based upon stage 1. So there's a considerable investment. So I do appreciate your comments and thoughtfulness, and hopefully we will be able to kind of address some of those issues as we move forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Councillor LeFranc.
Thank you, Daniel. I know how hard it is to get up and speak in front of City Council, and it can take your evening away from you. I just want to echo Councillor Gill's concerns. We just have almost a brand new local area plan that, mm-hmm. you know, went out for consultation in your area, and it's of concern when we feel like residents don't necessarily feel like they had an opportunity to have some say in it. Unfortunately, because we do have that plan, we do have a local area plan that we are following, and it's more than one developer. So it's a number of different developers who are all basing their plans on the local area plan that was passed. And so tonight at this council meeting, we are having to go with just this particular development application based on what the developer understood to be the plan. So mm-hmm. I recognize that it's tough, but thank you for coming out today.
Yeah, no, and thank you for that. I'm not so necessarily opposed to it. I think I heard there's at least 16 people here plus another that are in favor of that. And I think generally speaking, I am in favor of development of that area just because it does need to be developed. I think just on the heels of that the last council meeting, and obviously that was, you know, because I have a lot of friends who did come to that meeting and did speak their concerns, and I think this just coming on the heels of that, because it's literally across the street. So I just wanted the council to continue to be aware, and I'm sure you are aware that this following up on that, maybe people may not say anything anymore, but I think some people have just resided themselves to the fact. But I feel like I can still go back to my neighbors and say, well, I raised it at council, and you still have an obligation to get more involved and speak your mind. So,
thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, sir. I'm just wondering, planning, if you could put up the schematic on the developer's proposal, please. Okay, so I have a question here for you, sir. So the lots basically from 1 to 9 are RF lots.
Sorry?
They're RF lots.
Right.
Right. And then, of course, you've got the two oversized lots.
Yeah.
And your concern was?
So my concern is just that as you go down 98, like the lots are all fairly consistent, right? These are older lots, but it just seems like within a span of half a block, you're squeezing in 9 RF1 lots. And, you know, if that's, again, to maintain consistency with what's going to happen on the other side of 179, then that's fine. But I think what the people on the east side of 179 are feeling is you've suddenly brought in 9 extra homes into such a small area of space where there's like 3 houses per street. So, I mean, again, you know, I'm one street down, and I'm sure I'm going to have the same discussion when 180A goes through that cul-de-sac, and I'm sure, assuming this goes through, then the same amount of lots are going to continue to go down 179 up north. So, again, some of this is just for my own understanding. Some of this is for me to go back to my neighbors and explain to them to the points that you've already raised. So, yeah. So,
okay. Very good.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much for coming out tonight.
Thank you.
Okay, so I'll make the first call for other speakers on this matter. Yes, Deb Jack first, please.
Good evening, Deb Jack, Surrey Environmental Partners. I'd like to draw your attention to the fact that 77 out of 80 mature trees are going to be killed off. Pardon me, and this represents an enormous loss of canopy and urban wildlife habitat with regards to birds, insects, small mammals, etc. In addition to which, the fact that we can identify them as pollinators, which contribute to the growing of the gardens in the neighbourhood and on gardens in the yards and decks. There's no indication in the report that the 77 trees are of, I suppose, ill health, near dying or whatever, as often has been seen in reports. And in looking at the tree layout, it seems to me that maybe some more trees could have been saved with greater attention paid on the importance of taking out all of the trees. Some of those trees would border along property lines or on what we would think of as being the boulevard. The layout for that was on Appendix 6. There's only going to be 29 trees on the 11 lots. That's what the plan is. Yes. Seems to me on there's some trees that might have been considered for saving. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yes, ma'am. Can I have your name, please?
My name is Jenny Nam, 989 188 Street.
Okay, just repeat your name again, ma'am.
Jenny Nam.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I just want to affirm my two of the speakers in front of me. What I want to reiterate was that average lots in 98, that pocket, is over 10,000 square feet. So some of these houses are around 5,000 to 7,000 square feet. That's why I think having these high-density houses built in that block, 9 homes, I think is just it's a lot, and it's going to continue to build upon 179. So if you ever visit and drive down through 179, currently the road is so narrow right now that you can't even park on that street right now. So, and there are no TransLink or bus public transportation access in this pocket. So I presume that any residents who's going to live here is going to own a car. And on average, most homes own two cars. And if they have a tenant, it's going to bring an additional car. So, so if you include this new development along with the neighboring 50-plus homes, you're going to, you can imagine hundreds of cars that's going to bring. 1 kilometer radius of this development, including our home, we are sandwiched between Barnston Drive, Highway Number 1, Golden Ears Connector, Highway 17. So it's, it feels like a Bermuda Triangle in there if you ever drive there, and CN Rail. So in the last 5 years, I've attended numerous Fraser Heights Association meetings, signing many petitions, asking the CN Rail to reduce their train horn, address a side, and even just asking the city to develop sidewalks for 179, especially 179. So none of the residents can take their kids and walk along this street because there's two ditches on both sides. And there's no sidewalk. So I am for the development, but what I'm asking is to reduce the sizes so that it can accommodate, I guess, the road and plus area for these parking, assuming that all this house is going to have average of 3 cars each, plus a sidewalk for the residents to have a safe area to walk. Secondly, the trees. Along Barnston Drive East, about 5 years ago when Highway 1 was expanded, all the trees along that area was torn down. And they did build a noise wall, but what they placed was this wooden noise wall. And none of the trees that was replaced survived. So currently, they're all dead right now. So I understand that the developer in the city is proposing that you're going to replace some of these trees, but we're talking about mature trees that's been here for who knows when. So what I'm asking the council and the city is that working with the developer to ensure and to protect the ecology and the environment of this neighborhood. And I didn't address the townhouse area as well, but that's another 1 kilometer radius that all these trees were taken down. So those are my two main concerns and what I want to ask the council to look into and continue to evaluate this community.
Okay, any questions? Thank you very much. I have some questions for you, Councilor Frank.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and through you to Mr. Engineer. Are there sidewalks and road widenings planned for this development?
Through the chair, the Councilor Frank, yes, there is. Requirements are include road frontage works, including sidewalks and pathways throughout the neighborhood. And these get delivered as the projects advance.
They'll be delivered as per the development happens.
That's correct.
Okay. Thank you. Is that Councillor Frank? You have any more?
No, no? I'm fine.
Thank you. Councillor Hain.
I had the same question, so asked and answered. Thank you.
I want to invite you guys, if you ever want to come to the neighborhood, I would love to show you guys because this is like one-dimensional map. And if you go to Bing or Google Street View, you will see how this neighborhood looks like. So if you ever are in the area, I would love to give you a tour and share with you. So.
Okay, we've got some more questions.
Sure.
Here. Councillor Gill.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just to Mr. Engineer, is the services that are being proposed, are they the full standards in terms of the roads and sidewalks, or is it a reduced standard?
There are full standards.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. You understand that, ma'am?
Yes.
Yeah. So as the area develops, the sidewalks and the road will be developed along with that. Okay?
Thank you.
Thank you very much for your submission. Is there anyone else that wishes to speak to this? First call still. Yes, sir. Name and address,
please.
Evening.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. My name is Ed McIntosh, 11136 156 A Street in Surrey. And I am also the president of the Fraser Heights Community Association, and I don't want to get into necessarily arguing again over how this plan came to be. We have been extremely distressed and have tried to explain that, and when we hear that we had time to speak out, we're trying to find where that was. We were told that when this plan was adopted by council in December, there was no public input, there was no public hearing. There was two public hearings and one that we invited the staff to come to. And we think that, unfortunately, we think they came there with a plan in mind and they just did the minimum that they had to and ran away. And it's not just this community. This is the central part of it. It's the whole east end of Fraser Heights that this land use plan, concept plan was in. And it just seems terrible that we stand here now arguing or opposing one development after the other when a little more, as a matter of fact, quite a bit more public consultation and input up front would have and could have avoided a lot of that. However, what is done, and we move on from here. With this particular one, the Community Association has not heard a lot of opposition to this plan. And we do not oppose this plan because other than the one that is to immediately beside it, which we vociferously objected to, the RF-13, this one is a lot of the same size of lots are predominant in Fraser Heights. In this community, it would not have been unexpected that they could have even been larger, I think, is the other resident. I'm very glad, by the way, thank you guys for coming out and speaking, because sometimes we stand there, I stand here, and you see an association when you hear the residents, and that's why I like to love to have them come out and speak up, because I think you listen perhaps more to them than you would to me, but at least I try to put the cross. And I think Fraser Heights Community Association has a good reputation of trying to do the best that it can under whatever circumstances we run into to represent all the citizens of our area. But at the same time, when I say that we are not opposing this, that always comes with the three main concerns that we always have. One is, where is our children going to go to school? Where are all the cars are going to get parked? And tree canopy. That is always a major concern, and especially in this area when I think the numbers were there's like three trees being saved out of the whole bunch, and I don't know how healthy they are. But in any event, the bottom line is we are not opposing this particular application because we think it fits more into the culture and the fit of the community as a whole, and in particular to Abbey Ridge. Now, I also received this afternoon an email, and I think the city clerk and perhaps the council did as well, of an individual who was going to come and speak tonight but has taken ill and was unable to make it. And I have his email here, and it has like five questions in it. I'm wondering if I could be his surrogate to ask.
Is this Arthur Bias?
Yes, Arthur Bias, yes.
Yes, we do have that correspondent, sir.
Okay, would I be able to ask the questions for the answers?
That's your prerogative, sir, if you wish to.
Okay, well, if you all have it, I have two copies if you need one.
No, we all have copy of it,
okay,
sir.
Okay, then I would, as he has stated, he is a long-term resident and lives practically next door. If you look at his address there, 98 and 180th, he's basically next door. And the first question there is the RF lots along 98. Do you want me just to read the whole thing rather than trying to paraphrase it, or what would be best?
Probably if you read the whole thing, that way there's a clear understanding and we can ask the planner.
Okay, the number one says RF lots along 98th Avenue. We are asking to reduce the number of lots along 98th Avenue to create a better transition into the Abbey Ridge half-acre gross density subdivision. In brackets, reduce by one and increase the width of the remainder lots on 98th to better reflect the half-acre lots size, end of brackets. This may be achievable by reducing the lot width only along 179th to allow them to make up this extra lot. but not RF13s, just a modified RF lot.
Okay, we have that, sir. That's a statement. Go ahead, number two, please.
Well, he's wondering how, if we can get the question is to reduce this by one and widen the lots, as was stated by the previous resident there, the lots along 98th Avenue to be wider, to be more reflective of the other lots that are immediately adjacent.
Well, Mr. Planner, can you respond to this, please? I believe the local area plan may play into this.
Yes, Mr. Chair, the proposed lots fronting 98th Avenue and 179th Street are RF lots. They meet the minimum lot area and lot dimensions of RF lots, and they are consistent with the Avery Ridge local area plan.
To answer your question, sir, so it is consistent.
Well, is that a yes or is that a no?
With this application, unless the council decides to send it back to staff, it'll be proceeding as it is.
Well, then we request that you do refer it back so that
yes,
it can
you
be
can
considered.
Make that
okay,
request,
I did,
sir.
Okay.
Number two.
Number two is the street parking on 98th Avenue is a partial road, and the north side is already constructed to the one-half road standard. As the south side is not developed, council should instruct staff to make sure that street parking is not permitted until the south side of 98th is developed. This will mean more people parking in our neighborhood for the potential new suites, but at least we will be able to get in and out of the neighborhood and not have to maneuver around cars on the non-completed portion of 98th Avenue.
Very good. Could I just ask planning, is there any intention to restrict parking in that area at this time?
To the chair, typically through the detailed design, we'll look at the width that we can achieve with the available dedication. If the roads are too narrow, the constructed road are too narrow, we would limit parking. If we can get enough pavement width, we would allow parking, and we look at that through detailed design.
So they will look at that, sir, at the time.
When it's being built, when the subdivision is put into place?
Okay.
Three is tree replacement. The applicant is only retaining three trees and replanting 26 in a 12-lot subdivision. Total number of trees to be planted, as per the report, is 126. We believe each RF lot can easily handle one more tree per lot, and the RFG lots can take at least another two trees. As such, council should direct staff to have the applicant to add more trees to each lot so the neighborhood benefits from the trees being removed. As well, maybe the applicant can plant street trees in our neighborhood, as our neighborhood never got street trees. This would be for residents who would like a street tree or two. And I know one of the things that always keeps coming up is we see that so many trees just disappear. X number of thousands of dollars gets paid into the tree fund, and our question is, where does that money all go? Why can't we have it back in our area? And we never seem to get an answer to that either.
Okay, just before we go to staff on this, I just want to make it clear. The report says that 26 replacement trees are going to be put in, not 126.
Oh, sorry, my.
No, you. That's what it says.
Yes.
Yeah, read it.
Okay,
reading there.
Yeah.
So, staff, could you tell us what that fund is used for, please?
Yes, Mr. Chair. The Green City Fund, those funds go towards tree planting in various areas, typically in the neighborhood.
So, in other words, sir, we do try to put the trees back in the neighborhoods where we take them out.
Okay, I'm going to do a little review on that because we've had an awful lot of development with an awful lot of trees missing or being taken out on every proposal that comes forward, and I've never heard that yet said or committed to. So we'll be looking at that and seeing where we have some good ideas. The only one was, I should, one exception, Parkview Place. We did have a discussion with the, I just forget the gentleman's name now, from the park or whatever that looks after the tree fund. And because there's a bit of a park there, and it was, some of it was city land, there could be some planted there, but I've never heard that they would go back in and plant them in other areas. Number four is the building guidelines. Direct staff to remove vinyl siding from the building scheme as an acceptable building material for two reasons. One, vinyl does not exist in the existing neighborhood. And two, in smaller lots as seen in Edmonton approximately 5 years ago, where 20 plus homes burnt, and just recently in a Port Moody house fire, vinyl is a flammable material that transfers fire easily from one home to another. It also devalues the neighboring properties.
Okay, that's a request. City staff, is vinyls in this proposal?
Yeah, Mr. Chair, the building design guidelines do indicate some vinyl siding, but not on the front elevation of the homes, only at the sides and at the rear of the house currently.
Okay. So what, okay, what do we need to do to upgrade that?
Well, that's something we can consider.
Okay.
When we look at the overall.
Okay. Thank
okay.
You.
Environmental, sir?
The existing two lots have been used as businesses in the past and up to recently for the repair of small garden equipment. Brackett's corner lot was lawnmower repair business until 15 years ago in the Brackett's, and boat trailer repairs to the adjoining lot until this year. Please confirm that prior to submission or subdivision being granted, that the existing lots receive a clean environmental certificate, as these two businesses would have had some amounts of oil, gas, paints, or other chemicals used currently and in the past.
Planning, can I get you to comment on that, please?
Yes, Mr. Chair. With the application, the city does receive a soil contamination questionnaire from the applicant. I don't believe anything was identified, but we can follow up on that.
I would suggest very strongly that with the types of businesses that's been there over the last good number of years, there's a lot of stuff in the soil that just shouldn't be there, and it would not be wise to be building homes on.
That's one thing that can be followed up on, sir, in before any issuing of a development permit.
Okay, appreciate that. For that, thank you very much.
Very good. Thank you very much, sir. Okay, I'm going to make a second call for any speakers on this matter. Yes, ma'am. State your name, please, and your address.
My name is Kathy Doyle, and I live at 9918 180th A Street. I've lived there for 20 years, raised four kids from kindergarten through SFU master's degree, and we've done everything from chauffeur to school, to buy a third car so they can get to their job at McDonald's, to drive them to the bus stop, you know. So the issue for me is parking. And, you know, I think all of us who are residents there, one of the things, like Clayton Heights is an area where it's beautiful, but if you've known anybody that's lived there, parking is really a killer, and I don't think we want to become that. And so whatever the zoning is, I guess it seems to me that the logical rule of thumb would be have enough off-street parking for however many cars you're going to expect to be in those houses. And the reality is we have no functional transit. I mean, if you've got a job, you pretty much have to drive to it. So if you have two adults and there are, you know, 1.3 kids in any house, and you have a suite in the basement, whether it's 1.6 or 2.0 tenants, you're going to have sort of, you know, between 3.8 and 4 cars. And so I guess my rule of thumb would be if whatever you're proposing, if there's enough off-street parking for that many cars, you know, the rest of it should kind of fall into place. I guess that's my point, because the reality is our area needs that many cars. You can't go get a loaf of bread or a jug of milk without getting into your car. And if we have enough parking, like, I'm excited for development. I'm really looking forward to it. But it needs to be development where, not like where my daughter was a tenant in Clayton Heights. She says, it's so terrible with the parking, I would never live in that area again. So let's do it right up here, because it's a beautiful area. Thank you.
Okay, very good. I just want to ask a question of planning, please. How many on-site on each lot parking?
I'm sorry, were you talking to me?
No, I'm talking to planning. Thank you.
Yes, Mr. Chair, there'd be a minimum of 4 off-site or off-street parking stalls, 2 in the garage and 2 on the driveway at a minimum.
So each lot will have 4
okay.
parking stalls?
My comment with that would be is if you have a suite in the basement, the reality is the garages are going to be for stuff. Like, in theory, they're for cars, but in reality, they're going to be for stuff. So you're going to need driveways that can host four cars if you're going to have, if the facts are going to be the tenants.
Councillor Gill.
Mr. Chair, I just want to clarify with engineering that, in fact, if a home is proposing to have a secondary suite, that the secondary suite also requires an off-street parking. Is that correct? So would these homes now that we are speaking of, the RF lots, now accommodate five cars in total, in fact?
That's correct. They have to prove that they have adequate parking for the proposed suite, which in this case would be five parking spaces on the property.
So no suite, four cars with a suite, five. Is that correct?
So you're saying five off-street parking, and does that include the garage, which is going to be packed with stuff or not?
That's my understanding, yes.
Yeah, my comment would be make the setback a little longer so you can fit those cars on the driveway would be the practical way to count that space. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for your submission. Still on the second call for any speakers. Yes, ma'am. State your name, please.
My name is Maggie Coca. I work with Applin & Martin, and we are the agents on the file. I just wanted to take a quick moment and address one of the comments from the previous speaker with regards to the email from Arthur Bussier with reducing the number of lots along 98th and increasing the number of lots along 179. We looked at that. That was a comment that was presented to us, and we reviewed it. That would result in lots on 179 being less than 13 meters wide, wouldn't even comply with an RF 13. And so that's why the decision was made to leave the layout as it was.
Very good. Thank you very much. Now on the third call for any speakers. Third call, final call for any speakers on this matter. Okay, Madam Clerk.
Next, bylaw zoning, zoning amendment bylaw 19159. The addresses are 8910 120th Street and 8918, 8942, and 66 120th Street. The applicant is Kana Management Limited. The applicant is seeking to rezone the site from Comprehensive Development Bylaw 9399 to Comprehensive Development. The applicant is proposing to develop a three-story commercial building with retail, office, and banquet hall uses. The proposed building will also contain two levels of underground parking and two levels of above-ground parking.
Thank you very much, Madam Clerk. We have five pieces of correspondence on the table with regards to this matter. The concerns basically are after-hour noise, lack of parking, traffic congestion. I have no one signed up requesting to speak on this matter, so I'll therefore make first call for any speakers on this matter. First call. Second call. Third and final call. Are there any speakers on this matter? Madam Clerk, next.
Is zoning text amendment bylaw number 19135, and this is for this zoning bylaw 12,000 as amended, is further amended in Schedule F and G to include amenity contributions for the Abbey Ridge Local Area Plan, as described in Corporate Report 2017-R032. Copies of the bylaw and related documents can be viewed at City Hall or online.
Okay. I have no pieces of correspondence on the table with regards to this matter. We have 14 people in attendance who are for the development but not wishing to speak. We have one person in attendance.
It's not in development, it's the amenity charges.
Yeah, right. In the public hearing. We have one who is not identified whether they wish to speak or not. So I'm going to make on number four, first call for speakers. Second call for speakers. Third and final call for any speakers. Okay, that is the end of the public hearing portion. So, We'll move to committee reports.
I'll move the minutes of the Social Policy Advisory Committee. Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
And I'll move the minutes of the Cultural Development Advisory Committee, November 15. Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move the minutes to be received from the Environmental Sustainability Advisory Committee meeting of February 1st, 2017.
Second. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move the minutes to be received for the Agriculture and Food Security Advisory Committee of February 2nd, 2017.
Second. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move minutes be received, Surrey Heritage Advisory Commission, January 25th.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
And move recommendations be adopted.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Proclamations. I have quite a few of them here. I'm going to try and just pare down some of them. But the first one is in regards to World Down Syndrome Day. Whereas World Down Syndrome Day is a global awareness day that has been officially observed by the United Nations since 2012. And there are currently over 40,000 Canadian citizens who have Down syndrome. Individuals with Down syndromes have tremendous potential to live full and fulfilling lives as contributing members of the community. The City of Surrey values our citizens with Down syndrome and their families, and the city fully supports the rights, inclusion, and well-being of all individuals with Down syndrome. Therefore, be it resolved that I, Councillor Dave Woods, on behalf of Mayor Linda Heppner, do hereby declare March the 21st, 2017, as World Down Syndrome Day in the City of Surrey. Proclamation number two, Raise Your Hands Against Racism Day. The City of Surrey is committed to the belief that equal opportunity and treatment should exist for all people. And whereas every citizen of Surrey has a right to realize his or her full potential, regardless of color, race, nationality, or ethnic origin, and live at all times in conditions of dignity, respect, and peace. Whereas Raise Your Hands Against Racism is an opportunity to encourage residents to add their handprint and voice to say that racism does not serve our community and should be eradicated from our society on this day and throughout the year. Now, therefore, be it resolved that I, Councillor Dave Woods, on behalf of Mayor Linda Heppner, do hereby declare March 21st, 2017, as Raise Your Hand Against Racism Day in the City of Surrey. Next proclamation is Earth Hour 2017. Whereas Earth Hour has grown from one-day initiative in 2007 to a global movement uniting people to take action to create a sustainable world. And Earth Hour brings together communities from across the world celebrating that commitment to the planet by symbolizing switching off lights for one designated hour of 8:30 to 9:30 p.m. on Saturday, March 25th, 2017. The City of Surrey commits to participating in Earth Day 2017 by raising awareness of the event and turning off lights in the appropriate city facilities at that time. Whereas employees, residents, and businesses of the City of Surrey are encouraged to participate in Earth Day to be part of the global movement and turn off their lights for 1 hour on Saturday, March 25th at 8:30 p.m. Now, therefore, be it resolved that I, Councillor Dave Woods, on behalf of Mayor Linda Heppner, do hereby declare March 25th, 2017, as Earth 2017 in the City of Surrey. Earth Hour. Autism Awareness Day. Whereas autism spectrum disorder is a developmental disability which occurs in approximately 1 in 68 births, the cause of which are not fully understood. And autism spectrum disorder is characterized by difficulties in communication, social interaction, and behavior with significant variability against individuals who share the diagnosis. The City of Surrey and the Canucks Autism Network wish to raise the awareness of the public and practicing professionals by providing information on autism and spectrum disorder. The goal being to create inclusive communities where those affected by autism spectrum disorder are fully engaged and feel understood. And now, therefore, be it resolved that I, Councillor Dave Woods, on behalf of Mayor Linda Heppner, do hereby declare the month of April 2017 as Autism Awareness Month and April 2nd, 2017 as Autism Awareness Day in the City of Surrey. Next proclamation is Daffodil Month. Whereas the Canadian Cancer Society of British Columbia and the Yukon Division continues to be a leader in funding outstanding cancer research, undertaking cancer prevention initiatives, and delivering support services to people with cancer and their families. Whereas the Canadian Cancer Society of British Columbia and the Yukon Division assists the public in taking steps to reduce the risk of cancer by adopting prevention strategies and advocates for health public policies that make healthier choices and easier choices. Now, therefore, be it resolved that I, Councillor Dave Woods, on behalf of Mayor Linda Heppner, do hereby declare the month of April 2017 as Daffodil Month in the City of Surrey. Next proclamation. Male Survivors of Sexual Abuse Awareness Month, April 2017. Whereas the problem of child sexual abuse persists in an atmosphere of silence and ignorance. Whereas the problem of boyhood sexual exploitation is often overlooked and neglected and poorly understood. Whereas all adult survivors advocated for the prevention of childhood sexual abuse and for the development of effective and comprehensive recovery and rehabilitation programs for victims. Now, therefore, be it resolved that I, Councillor Dave Woods, on behalf of Mayor Linda Heppner, do hereby declare April 2017 as Male Survivors of Sexual Abuse Awareness Month in the City of Surrey. Next proclamation, Punjabi Heritage Month, April 2017. Whereas Punjabis began their migration to Canada over a century ago and have made significant contributions to the social, economic, political, and cultural fiber of our city. The City of Surrey prides itself on being one of the most multicultural cities in Canada and home to people from all over the world. Whereas all the people of all faiths, cultures are welcome, respected, and able to live in harmony. Whereas an event such as Vaisakhi is an opportunity for all to celebrate, raise awareness of this rich culture by participating in the largest Vaisakhi parade outside of India, which is held in Surrey every April. Now, therefore, be it resolved that I, Dave Woods, on behalf of Mayor Linda Heppner, do hereby declare the month of April 2017 as Punjabi Heritage Month in the City of Surrey. Last proclamation is Organ and Tissue Donor Awareness Month, April 2017. Whereas there are currently 500 people in British Columbia waiting for organ transplant, and more than 5,400 British Columbians who have received this gift of life through organ donation since 1968. Whereas organ donors and their families have selflessly demonstrated compassion and kindness by sharing the gift of life with others. Whereas the British Columbia Transplant Society raises organ donor awareness through the community initiatives by informing the public on life-saving impact of registering as a donor and tissue donor, organ and tissue donor. Now, therefore, be it resolved that I, Councillor Dave Woods, on behalf of Mayor Linda Heppner, do hereby declare April 2017 as Organ and Tissue Donation Awareness Month in the City of Surrey. Okay. So we have no governmental reports on the table. We'll move into corporate reports.
Move corporate report R046, the closure of road adjacent to 1531, 1534, 15355, 15361, and 15371, 101 Avenue.
Second.
Seconder, Councillor Hain. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move corporate report R047, award of contract. To RICO Contracting in the amount of $1,067,838.45, and that relates to works on 51B Avenue and 188th Street for local road construction.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move Corp Report R048, the award of contract for major arterial road paving to Wind Van Paving in the amount of $3,453,707.62.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move Corp Report R049, award of contract for the construction of sanitary sewer upgrades to Padre Contractors in the amount of $2,866,500.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move Corp Report R050, award of contract for the distribution of water main construction to Padre Contractors in the amount of $1,859,751.60.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move corporate report R051, award of contract for Finlay Drainage Pump Station and Conveyance Works Construction to Westport Construction Group in the amount of $2,392,939.98.
Second. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move corporate report R052, the license agreement with Rogers Communications Canada, Inc. for use of road allowances.
Second. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move corporate report R053, the heritage road markers and district signage in the Cloverdale Town Center.
Second. Very good. We have discussion here. Councillor Villeneuve.
Thank you. This is a report on heritage road markers and the district signage in the Cloverdale Town Center. And I just wanted to comment, it's a good report, and I'm glad to see the integration of the signs. Because what you find, particularly in smaller areas, if there's signs for everything, it becomes clutter. So I think the fact that you're integrating the signs is a really good thing to be doing to keep the character of the city. So thank you.
Thank you. Very good. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move corporate report R054, the sponsorship request for the Indo-Canadian Dental Association in the amount of $2,500.
Second. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move corporate report R055, extension of tree watering contract with Horizon Landscape Contractors in the amount of $981,828.75.
Second. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move corporate report R056, award of contract for the 2017 landscape maintenance services for various city parks to Vane Lawn and Garden Services in the amount of $468,578.19.
Second. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move corporate report R057, the 2017 City Awards Program.
Second. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move corporate report R058, the proposed heritage property standards maintenance bylaw.
Second. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. I have to excuse myself on the next corporate. Councillor Gill, please.
I understand that the chair lives in Country Woods and such. I will be taking on this item, so if I could.
So I will move corporate report R059, the Country Woods subdivision request for OCP amendment.
Second.
Second.
Recommendation.
Seeing no questions, I'll call the question. All in favor? Against? Carried. Mr. Chair.
Thank you. And now we will move into bylaws and permits, and we'll move into business arising out of the public hearing.
Third reading on H1.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
On 2, move third on the OCP.
Second.
Very good. Councillor Hain.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I'd like to just ask staff that that we do have a review of the tree retention on these lots and see if there's any additional trees, first of all, that can be retained on the RF lots. And secondly, and with tree replanting on the lots and in the community to make sure that that we are sort of looking after the community first and any additional tree plantings and that would go into that Abbey Ridge area directly as a result of this and some of the future development that's going on here. Because obviously Abbey Ridge is going to be developed more and so concentrating some not only tree retention but tree replacement as much as possible in that area would be really good for the local community. Thank you.
Very good. Do we have anybody else who wishes to speak?
I just,
Councillor Dillon.
Well, I just want to comment that I was happy to see some people from the neighborhood come out and talk about why they're supporting the project. And because I think we do care about hearing from the public about their positions. And I think that the four or five items that were brought up out of Mr. Boosie's email can be adequately addressed by staff and just to ensure that as much as we can that there's adequate parking. I think we have some past history with some of those issues. So, I mean, the truth is that people do use their garages for other than cars at times. So we just have to be aware that we can try to provide some off-street parking if possible, too. So just like to make that comment.
Okay. Any further comments? Okay. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Also on 2 on the first zoning, move third.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
On the second zoning, move third.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Chair, obviously I supported this application, but certainly I think that given what we may be in store as we move forward, I did have an opportunity to speak to Planning Department, and I do understand that the Fraser Heights Community Association executive did not oppose the Stage 1 plan, or certainly they did not send a letter reflecting their concerns, nor was there a letter of objection received. That being said, I think that where my confusion lies is I do understand that there was a member of the executive that did send in some correspondence to planning staff, which resulted in some tweaks prior to Stage 2 being done. And so I'm quite confused in terms of the process, but certainly I think that, you know, having Fraser Heights Community Association being frustrated is not probably something that we would want to see ongoing. So certainly I'm going to ask staff to perhaps reach out to the association and look at some of the concerns that they do have, and perhaps look at the timelines, the processes that were employed. And I just don't want to replicate this issue as we move forward, but certainly I think that, you know, I'm quite concerned and quite disheartened that you know, given that the process that we did employ, given that there was an application, and I think that I think we did err on the side of caution by doing a local area plan that resulted in a Stage 1 and eventually a Stage 2. You know, I was thoughtful enough that I think that we have done that process, but certainly I think it might be appropriate for staff to circle back with the Community Association to have that level of discussion.
Okay. Agreed.
Any further discussion on that matter? Does staff need any clarification? You're all right with that? Very good. I already did call a question, so we'll move on to number
three.
Mr. Chair, if I could, I also understand that someone did make some concerns about some of the exterior cladding being vinyl, yes. And perhaps we could have staff work with the applicant and the community association to ensure that we have a higher quality of cladding outside of the vinyl siding. So I did hear that from the community. So if we could have staff address that, and I'll move that motion just to ensure
second.
That it does get addressed.
Very good. Any further discussion? Can I get seconder on that motion?
Second.
Second? Okay. Any discussion? No. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Staff is clear? Very good. Thank you very much.
Move third on three.
Second.
Mr. Chair.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move third on four.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
On five, move that the Mayor and Clerk be authorized to execute DVP 7916035800.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
On number six, move that the Mayor and Clerk be authorized to execute DVP 7916038300.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
On number seven, move that the Mayor and Clerk be authorized to execute DVP 7917001700.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
On number eight, move that the Mayor and Clerk be authorized to execute DVP 7916071700.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
On number nine, move that the Mayor and Clerk be authorized to execute DVP 7916017700.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
On 10, move that Council support the issuance of DVP 7912006600. If supported, the DVP will be brought forward for issuance and execution in conjunction with the final adoption of the related bylaw.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Okay. On number 11, we're moving into final adoptions. And I'll be calling here for any person wishing to make a presentation on this bylaw. The bylaw is 2017, number 18720. Is there anyone who wishes to make a presentation on this? First call. Second call. Third call. Very good.
Move final adoption on number 11.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Okay. With regards to number 12, bylaw 2017, number 18898. Is there anybody in attendance who wishes to make a presentation onto this matter? First call. Second call. Third call. Councillor Gill.
Final adoption on 12.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move final adoption on 13.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move final adoption on 14, which is the development application fee bylaw.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move final adoption on 15, which is the rural area service
second.
Road opening bylaw.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Introductions.
Move first on 16.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move second.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move third.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
On the Heritage Property Standards Maintenance Bylaw, move first.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move second.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move third.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
On the City of Surrey Vehicle for Hire Bylaw, move first.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move second.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move third.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Clerk's reports, number one.
Move 1A, which would permit the request for permission to hold an annual door-to-door fundraising drive.
Second.
For the Canadian Cancer Society.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
I'll move the recommendation for Councillor LeFranc's attendance.
Second.
At the Leadership Transition to Learn Forum.
Seconder. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move the item three, which is the parking patroller appointments.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Approval of financial statements and budgets. Newton Business Improvement.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Cloverdale Business Improvement Association.
Second.
So moved.
All those in favor?
Sorry.
Opposed? Carried. Go ahead, Councillor Gill.
Move item C, which is the Downtown Surrey Business Improvement Association.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.
And move D, which is the Fleetwood Business Improvement Association.
Very second. Good. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. We have no notices of motions. Is there any other business? Any other business?
I'll move adjournment.
Second on adjournment.
Second on adjournment. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried.